This is a talk about libertarianism and reactionary thought. Reactionary thought has returned to the forefront of political discussion in recent years. Its relationship to libertarianism eludes many people, who either claim that the two are antithetical in some way, or that libertarianism is better served by making other allegiances. First, we will examine how libertarianism and reaction work together to form a complete worldview. Second, we will see why combining each of them with anything else leads to disaster. Third, we will compare and contrast libertarianism with the alt-right, neo-reaction, and fascism. As Voltaire said, "If you wish to converse with me, first define your terms." Let us do this now. Libertarianism is a philosophical position on what constitutes the morally acceptable use of force. Libertarianism says that initiating the use of force is always immoral, but defensive uses of force are never immoral. Reaction is a political position that favors a return to some status quo ante, which is believed to have possessed desirable characteristics which are absent from the status quo. Let us elaborate upon reactionary thought. First, reactionaries are opposed to egalitarianism. They do not view all people as being equals. It follows that they support a hierarchy, with some people being regarded as superior to others. Second, reactionaries seek to cultivate discipline, while opposing all forms of social and cultural degeneracy. Many reactionaries will use the term degeneracy without taking the trouble to define it, so let us do so here. Degeneracy is behavior which is not conducive to civilization. Degenerate behavior may be fun or even beneficial in moderation, but when taken to excess, it will ruin a person's physical, mental, and spiritual health. When it becomes sufficiently widespread throughout a society, it will lead to civilizational decline. Third, reactionaries are opposed to liberalism, democracy, Marxism, globalism, and any other form of governance which would undermine traditional sources of authority, such as monarchs and state religions. Fourth, reactionaries tend to view tradition as a millennia-long collection of best practices, which should only be deviated from if circumstances require it. Fifth, reactionaries support nativism, which is the preservation of an indigenous culture. This manifests variously as anti-immigration policy and advocacy for ethnostates. Sixth, reactionaries oppose the concept of tabula rasa, believing instead that there is a strong genetic component to who each person is. Seventh, reactionaries oppose the idea of Whig history, which is the view that mankind has been on a journey of slow progress. Instead, they favor a cyclical view of history in which man rises to greatness, declines, and then the process repeats. Let us make some further observations upon reactionary thought. The common view of liberal as left-wing and conservative as right-wing is somewhat misguided. It makes more sense to judge political positions by how they intend to alter the political climate. As conservatism seeks to preserve the status quo, it makes more sense to think of it as centrist rather than rightist. Moderates, liberals, progressives, socialists, and communists are thus all on the left, as all seek to move society to the left with varying degrees of strength and speed. By this standard, only certain forms of reaction can be right-wing, as they are the only force that consistently pulls in the opposite direction of leftists. This means that conservatives can be opponents of reactionaries, and in unhealthy societies they frequently are. Finally, reaction is only proper in an unhealthy society, for if there is no mistake in need of fixing, there is no proper purpose for returning to a status quo ante. It is important to know what things are, but it is equally important to know what they are not. Thus, let us consider what libertarianism and reaction are not. Libertarianism is not a statement about more than self-ownership and non-aggression. Of course, a libertarian may believe many things besides this, but to claim that one must believe those things in order to be a libertarian is false, and anyone who says otherwise is a fake libertarian. Libertarianism is not a more general guide about how to behave, nor is it intended to be. It is simply an answer to one important philosophical question: when is it acceptable to use force? Because libertarianism is not a complete worldview, it needs a complement to inform its adherents about other issues besides the use of force. Reaction is not an ideology independent of context. In order to know what the status quo ante is, it is necessary to have an historical context. For example, a reactionary in 1795 France would seek to restore the Bourbon dynasty, while a reactionary in 1995 Russia would seek to restore the Soviet Union. These are radically different outcomes. It is thus clear that reaction does not provide an objective moral standard or a complete worldview. Thus, reaction needs a complement to inform its adherents about the nature of the mistakes which occurred in the past. By these descriptions, libertarianism and reaction are compatible. Reactionary thought can inform libertarians about other issues besides the use of force, while libertarianism can inform reactionaries about the nature of the mistakes which occurred in the past. But just because these ideologies are compatible does not mean that they must be combined. Other ideologies could combine with either libertarianism or reaction. In fact, if libertarianism will not inform reaction, something else will. And if reaction will not inform libertarianism, something else will. Next, we will explore each of these possibilities. The nature of reaction in the absence of libertarianism is rather straightforward. Far-right ideas will be combined with initiatory violence. The result of this has historically been despotic imperial rule. In more recent times, it has resulted in fascism and Nazism. The body count of these is second only to communism. Fortunately, we typically see less extreme forms of non-libertarian reaction. The most common of these is right-wing populism, which surfaces in Western countries about once per generation. These movements contain an unstable combination of welfare statism and traditional moral values. This is an unstable combination because it is the welfare state that has played the primary role in undermining traditional moral values. It does this by subsidizing degeneracy. It creates and exacerbates internal divisions between those who are expropriated and those who receive the expropriated money. For these reasons, among others, the welfare state is the source of the very problems that its proponents claim to want it to solve. As Hans Hermann Hoppe explains on page 195 of Democracy, the God That Failed, by relieving individuals of the obligation to provide for their own income, health, safety, old age, and children's education, the range and temporal horizon of private provision is reduced, and the value of marriage, family, children, and kinship relations is lowered. Irresponsibility, short-sightedness, negligence, illness, and even destructionism, bads, are promoted, and responsibility, farsightedness, diligence, health, and conservatism, goods, are punished." End quote. Now that we have an understanding of reaction without libertarianism, let us consider libertarianism without reaction. This may take many forms, but the most common form is that of non-aggression combined with the promotion of vices as though they were virtuous. This is the result of leftist infiltration, in accordance with Robert Conquest's second law, which says that any organization not explicitly and constitutionally right-wing will sooner or later become left-wing. This brings social justice warriors, egalitarians, hedonists, and other undesirable types into libertarian movements. This is dangerous because it confuses and repels potential recruits into libertarian movements. When people seeking a reprieve from state oppression and violence encounter a movement of people who seem to believe that anything drug-related is inherently libertarian, standards of public morality are manifestations of rape culture and patriarchy, and using one's private property rights and freedom of association for politically incorrect purposes is somehow anti-libertarian, they frequently decide not to take seriously such a movement as an avenue for the changes they seek, and they are not wrong about that. Another common feature of libertarianism without reaction is what the alt-right refers to as political autism. This term refers to a certain species of policy analysis, which exhibits many of the symptoms which are commonly found among high-functioning autistic people. First among these is a hyper-individualism that leaves one unable to recognize groups or deal with demographic issues. Second, political autism involves context denial. This leads to an incorrect ranking of options when the textbook libertarian answer is unavailable and one must choose the lesser of several evils. Third, politically autistic people can become obsessed with details to the point of being unable to grasp the larger picture. Fourth, political autism leads one to exclusively use reason and evidence, even after it becomes clear that one's target audience is not operating on that level and is instead operating emotionally. Reactionary thought is one of the most effective remedies in existence for political autism. Now let us combine libertarianism with reactionary thought. With regard to moral issues, vices that do not violate libertarian principles must be tolerated. We should not initiate the use of force against people who practice those vices, but toleration need not equal encouragement. Reactionary thought advises us that encouragement of vices weakens the members of a community. It also attracts addicts who will fake being a libertarian for their own selfish ends. A sufficiently weak community becomes ripe for conquest, so it becomes necessary for the members of a libertarian social order to establish norms of conduct above and beyond the non-aggression principle for the sake of preserving their social order. In the theoretical sense, libertarianism requires anarchy because the operation of a state apparatus is an affront to individual liberty and private property. Thus, libertarianism views the creation of states as a societal error which occurred in the past and is in need of correction. It is this fact that allows us to view libertarianism as a form of reaction. In fact, libertarianism is the most ancient and fundamental form of reaction because statism is the most ancient and fundamental societal error. Now that we have explored the relationship between libertarianism and reaction, let us turn our attention to the alt-right, neo-reaction, and fascism. In order to understand these ideologies, it is necessary first to consider their common antecedent political philosophers. Though an exhaustive list would be quite long, it will suffice to consider six of the most prominent philosophers. First, there is Joseph de Maistre, who lived from 1753 to 1821. He was a French-speaking Savoyard philosopher of the Counter-Enlightenment. He believed in the divine right of kings and considered monarchy to be the only stable form of government. He advocated in favor of hierarchy and monarchy following the French Revolution, calling for the Bourbon dynasty to be restored to the throne, and for ultimate papal authority in secular matters. He blamed the Reign of Terror following the French Revolution on the rationalist rejection of Christianity. Notably, he argued that as a practical matter, ultimate authority must be in the hands of an individual who is capable of decisive action. Since the 19th century, Maist's throne and altar paleo-reactionary view has declined in influence compared with his contemporary Edmund Burke, but the modern far right certainly favors the former over the latter. Second, there is Georg Friedrich Hegel, 1770-1831. He was a German philosopher who played an important role in developing German idealism. Hegelian thought split into two branches, the Young Hegelians and the Right Hegelians. The Young Hegelians eventually developed into the progressive leftists of today, but the Right Hegelians interpreted his work in a different way. Right Hegelians believe that ideas and institutions can only be understood by understanding their history. In Hegel's absolute idealism, the absolute is a non-personal substitute for the concept of a god. He believed that this absolute comes to fullest expression in the historical reality of the modern state. Accordingly, he praised the Prussian state, the most authoritarian regime of its time in the West. Third, there is Thomas Carlyle, 1795-1881. He was a Scottish philosopher, historian, essayist, satirist, and teacher. He took Maist's belief about ultimate authority needing to reside in the hands of an individual who is capable of decisive action to the next level, arguing that history is nothing but the biography of the great man. In mainstream circles, Carlyle is best known for coining the term the dismal science to refer to economics, which he did because he wished to reintroduce slavery into places where it had been abolished, and economists told him that this was a bad idea. His latter-day pamphlets, published in 1850, attacked both democracy and hereditary aristocracy. Like Hegel, Carlyle praised the Prussian state and wrote a positive portrayal of Frederick the Great, its king from 1740 to 1786. Fourth, there is Oswald Spengler, 1880 to 1936. He was a German historian and philosopher of history. Today, he is best known for publishing a book on world history called The Decline of the West in 1918. He argued that any culture, nation, or empire is a superorganism with a limited and predictable lifespan. He used the examples of the Second Intermediate Period and the formation of the New Kingdom in ancient Egypt, the classical Greco-Roman civilization, and the transition from the Warring States period to the Han Dynasty in ancient China to formulate a three-stage theory of political decline. He then applied this theory to Western civilization to predict that around the year 2000, it would enter a period of pre-death emergency whose countering would necessitate extra-constitutional omnipotence of the executive branch of the central government. This is to result in the strongest Western nation creating a global empire, which Spengler predicted would decline around the year 2200 and collapse between the years 2345 and 2400. The final years of Spengler's life were spent in Nazi Germany, which was interesting because he was critical of both Hitler and the Jews. Shortly before his death in 1936, he correctly predicted that the Reich would probably no longer exist in 10 years' time. Fifth, there is Carl Schmitt, 1888-1985. He was a German jurist and political theorist. He wrote extensively about political power, and is best known today for his 1932 work, The Concept of the Political. In it, he argued that the political domain is superior to all others, as questions of economics, religion, or anything else become political questions when there is sufficient controversy over them. He defined a political enemy as, quote, whoever is in a specially intense way existentially something different and alien, so that in the extreme case conflicts with him are possible. Schmitt believed that government must include a dictatorial element in order to be capable of decisive action. He regarded the sovereign as whoever decides on the exception or the appropriate moment for stepping outside the rule of law in the public interest in order to exercise this dictatorial element. Finally, there is Julius Evola, 1898-1974. He was an Italian philosopher, esotericist, and painter. Franco Ferraresi labeled Evola's work the most radical and consistent anti-egalitarian, anti-liberal, anti-democratic, and anti-popular system of thought in the 20th century. In his 1928 work, Pagan Imperialism, Evola argued that fascism should be the vehicle for reinstating the caste system and the aristocracy. In 1934's Revolt Against the Modern World, Evola argues that modernity represents a serious decline from an ideal society. He insists on non-modern forms, institutions, and knowledge as being necessary to produce a restoration. In the posthumously published Metaphysics of War, Evola argues that war could be a spiritually fulfilling experience. In his 1961 work, Ride the Tiger, Evola argues that the fight against modernity is lost. Thus, the proper course of action is to ride the tiger of modernity patiently and only act when it is tired of running. This informs the neo-reactionary view of passivism, which will be discussed later. Now that we understand the intellectual prehistory of the various far-right movements, let us explore the fundamental tenets of each one. First, let us consider the alt-right. Race is at the center of the alt-right worldview. Alt-right adherents view race not as a mere social construct, but as a biological phenomenon that separates people into distinct population groups. More intelligent members of the alt-right movement understand that race is a rather ill-defined concept in objectively measurable terms, and instead focus on subgroups within the races known as theeds. Theed is a word recovered from Old English, and it refers to a group of people who share a common ancestry in terms of culture, genetics, history, philosophy, and religion. The belief among members of the alt-right in irreconcilable differences between these population groups leads them to advocate for ethno-nationalism, which is the idea that each race or theed is entitled to a homeland exclusive to its members. Alt-rightists tend to favor economic protectionism and self-reliance as a means of strengthening their desired ethno-states, at least in terms of making themselves less dependent on trade with members of other racial groups. Despite their image as racial supremacists, members of the alt-right typically express no desire to rule over members of other races, preferring instead a true separation from them. This informs their non-interventionist stance on foreign policy. Finally, the alt-right has a collectivist theory of knowledge, which rejects universalism in favor of historicism, which is the idea of attributing meaningful significance to historical period, geographical place, and local culture. In terms of strategy, the alt-right pursues a more short-term and active approach than other far-right movements. They are best known for their use of meme warfare to make their political points and attract new followers. They also hold occasional public rallies, which tends to bring them into conflict with violent left-wing counter-protesters, because alt-right affiliated accounts on mainstream social media and crowdfunding sites are routinely banned. The alt-right has adopted a strategy of building alternative platforms. The alt-right does have some political parties of its own, though they are currently too small to accomplish anything notable. There is also a focus on self-improvement in the alt-right, because they reason that knowledge and physical fitness will aid their other objectives. Between libertarianism and the alt-right, there are several areas of compatibility and several areas of incompatibility. Both share a respect for self-determination and free association, viewing these as fundamental rights of all people. As such, libertarians and alt-rightists agree on a non-interventionist foreign policy. Both see self-improvement and entrepreneurship as important methods for overcoming the current political establishment. Furthermore, private property rights in a libertarian social order would allow alt-rightists to create ethnically homogeneous communities and exclude people on the basis of race. However, there is a large amount of support for national socialism within the alt-right, which is incompatible with libertarianism. More generally, libertarians tend toward individualism, while the alt-right tends toward collectivism, though neither is completely pure in these positions. While libertarians favor free trade and would only contemplate protectionism as a political tool to negotiate a lessening of tariffs between nations, the alt-right is deeply concerned with keeping jobs within a particular nation, even if doing so lessens economic efficiency. Finally, many people in the alt-right are deeply anti-Semitic, while libertarianism would not exist as we know it without the contributions of Jewish thinkers such as Ludwig von Mises, Ayn Rand, and Murray Rothbard. There are three important lessons that libertarians can learn from the alt-right. First, the alt-right is much better at getting and using media attention. They get far more news coverage, despite being outnumbered many times over by libertarians. Second, there is a tendency among libertarians to view people as atomized individuals. Libertarians could learn from the alt-right about the importance of the role of community. Third, the alt-right can help libertarians deal with leftist identity politics. Though libertarians correctly find identity politics to be distasteful, it is the weapon in play, and refusing to use it while the enemies of liberty are using it puts libertarians at a disadvantage. Second, let us consider the neo-reactionary movement, also known as the Dark Enlightenment. Neo-reactionaries describe contemporary Western society as being in a state of social decay which is masked by increasing wealth and technological advancement. Many would argue that these advancements are actually the cause of the aforementioned social decay. Neo-reactionaries are opposed to Enlightenment values, such as egalitarianism, liberalism, and democracy. They favor non-democratic, imperial forms of government, such as traditional monarchy. Some favor a form proposed by Mencius Moldbug known as neocameralism, a political system in which governments are run as shared stock corporations for profit. Another neo-reactionary political theory called formalism proposes that the official narrative ought to be made congruent with the unofficial power dynamics, even formalized as shares in a corporation. Neo-reactionaries emphasize passivism, or the opposite of activism. This is an intentional and principled avoidance of political activism, as neo-reactionaries regard activism as counterproductive and a violation of formalism. Finally, neo-reactionary theory places importance on the Männerbund, which is German for a league of men. This refers to the fact that in traditional societies, it was the role of able-bodied men to defend their communities from all threats, foreign and domestic. This meant both repelling external invasions and working to maintain the norms of the community. Neo-reactionaries view the Männerbund as a more fundamental foundation for civilization than even the family unit. Thus, anything that weakens the bonds between heterosexual males is viewed as degenerate by neo-reactionaries. For the neo-reactionary plan, we may look at their own words from neoreaction.net, quote, "Real leadership would undertake a proper corporate restructuring of United States government, pardon and retire all employees of the old regime, formalize obligations as simple financial instruments, nationalize and restructure the banks, media, and universities, and begin the long, slow process of organic cultural recovery from centuries of dysfunction," end quote. Neo-reactionary strategy begins with building alternative institutions. The activism of the alt-right is shunned by neo-reactionaries. Instead, neo-reactionaries focus on self-improvement. A popular phrase within their circles is, "Become worthy, accept power, rule." The ideas expressed in this phrase are that if one accepts power or attempts to rule without being worthy, then one will use power incorrectly and fail to hold it. Also, one obviously cannot rule if one rejects power. Neo-reactionaries seek both to persuade current elites to their way of thinking and to educate a new class of statesmen in order to form a new aristocracy. The end goal of these measures is to restore a non-democratic imperial government with a great man in charge of it. Just as between libertarianism and the alt-right, there are several points of agreement and several points of disagreement between libertarianism and neo-reaction. Although traditional monarchy is not a goal of libertarianism, it is superior to the democratic state for the purpose of preserving liberty. In a libertarian social order, a private property owner is a sort of monarch over one's estate. The neo-reactionary concept of a sovereign corporation is more contentious with libertarian philosophy, but a property owner could use such a structure to govern a very large holding that is too difficult to manage oneself. Neo-reactionaries and libertarians both view democracy with contempt, though for slightly different reasons. Both find self-improvement and entrepreneurship to be useful means of achieving their preferred forms of social order. That being said, there are several points of conflict between libertarianism and neo-reaction. The end goal of neo-reaction is a form of corporate statism, while libertarians seek to end the state and replace the statist corporate form with a business structure that has more accountability. The problem of nation-states that have the geography, population, economics, and military of an empire coupled with a non-imperial governmental structure is approached differently. Libertarians would abolish the empire, while neo-reactionaries would restore an imperial government. Neo-reactionaries seek a great man to wield state power effectively, but libertarians believe that no such man can exist and that state power is too dangerous to be allowed to persist. Finally, libertarians do not share the neo-reactionary aversion to political activism, though perhaps they should. The most important lesson that libertarians can learn from neo-reactionaries is the understanding of power dynamics in society. This will help libertarians avoid meaningless and counterproductive battles, as well as overcome the political autism that runs rampant in mainstream libertarian movements. Third, let us consider fascism. all fascist regimes have a strong focus on the leader of the nation. In accordance with Carlyle's theory of the great man, the leader is someone who represents the people but also transcends them. In accordance with Schmitt's theory of the sovereign, the leader decides under which conditions he will step outside the rule of law and do whatever he deems necessary. Fascism is also defined by a sense of ultranationalism. This is evident by the constant use of flags, political rallies, patriotic songs, and national symbols. This also manifests in the form of militarism. Fascist regimes venerate martial values. They seek to apply wartime practice to peacetime and foreign policy principles to domestic policy. They are obsessed with national security and suppression of cultural norms that are in opposition to the regime. Fascist regimes use this to stay in power by unifying the masses against a perceived common threat, which commonly takes the form of an ethnic or religious minority. Finally, fascist regimes are defined by an extreme form of corporatism, in which political leaders and business leaders work together to set policy. There is no current fascist strategy which falls outside of the aforementioned plans of alt-rightists and neo-reactionaries, so let us proceed to the compatibilities and incompatibilities between libertarianism and fascism. Libertarians and fascists are both opposed to democracy and are interested in pursuing virtue. But while libertarians believe that virtue will be found through freedom, fascists seek virtue by means of control. Of the three far-right ideologies discussed here, the fascist position on economics is least compatible with libertarianism, as fascists support statism and oppose both capitalism and private property. Their view of the nation as the ultimate property owner and private holders as mere stewards is an affront to libertarian notions of ownership. That being said, it is possible for a private property owner to administer one's holdings according to the structure of a fascist dictatorship. Being the owner of property means having a right to exclusive control over it, including its governance structure. However, libertarian standards do not permit forcing non-aggressive people to come into such a territory or remain there against their will, so a libertarian running a fascist governance structure within private property will be fundamentally different in both practice and result from historical cases of fascism. Despite their differences, libertarians can still learn important lessons from fascists. Their methods for suppressing the statist left are worthy of study, even though most would require refinement and confinement to be used by libertarians. Fascist political philosophy also contains useful information about the importance of in-group preference and the advantage that groups with it have over groups without it. Libertarians can learn from the failures of fascist regimes as well, particularly with regard to attacking too many enemies at once and failing to stop leftist rebels from overthrowing them. In conclusion, as Hoppe writes on page 202 of Democracy, the God That Failed, quote, "The relationship between libertarianism and conservatism is one of praxeological compatibility, sociological complementarity, and reciprocal reinforcement." End quote. The same is true of libertarianism and reaction. They are pieces of a whole. Combining one or the other with something else leads to disaster. Libertarians should be reactionaries, and reactionaries should be libertarians. Alt-rightists, neo-reactionaries, and fascists are all potential allies against the statist left. With minor adjustments, all of these ideologies may be practiced within private property in a libertarian social order. However, as currently and historically practiced, their long-term goals are at odds with libertarianism. As such, they are likely to betray libertarians if and when the statist left is defeated. Therefore, libertarians must be ready to defend themselves against right-wing authoritarianism. The End.